Hello students, we'll be discussing the polity questions from the mains 2022 GS paper 2. I'll be discussing the polity questions alone. So how the questions were asked, so what is the source for the question, and is it current affairs oriented or is it like static? So everything we'll discuss in this session. Okay, so overall the paper is a moderate paper, not too difficult and not too easy. It is a mix of both current affairs and static. So like 50% of the questions were directly asked from the current affairs related aspects and 50% were asked from static, and some one or two questions were unconventional also. Okay, so we'll discuss one by one. First question: constitutional morality is rooted in the constitution itself and is founded on its essential facets. Explain the doctrine of constitutional morality with the help of relevant judicial decisions. So this is the first question. It's a 10 mark question. The key word here is constitutional morality. Constitutional morality. So recently in Sabarimala judgment also, this term constitutional morality was used. So first in the introduction, you want to tell what is constitutional morality. So constitutional morality is a coordination between the conflicting ideals, the conflicting interests between different groups of the people or between the people and the state or whatever it might be, and how it is going to be solved. That is through judiciary. So this is the crux of the question. What you are going to do is that first in the introduction, you are going to tell what is constitutional morality, and in the body you are going to tell what are all the aspects in the constitution which are dealing with this constitutional morality. Okay, many aspects are there. It is a 10 mark question, so we are not going to discuss everything. So you can tell about rule of law, you can tell about freedom of speech and expression, you can tell about social justice, you can tell about due process of law and procedure established by law, established by law. Some examples you can give. You can explain these concepts in 2 lines. Then you should tell about some judgments which actually like reiterated the constitutional morality again and again. So you can tell about Shankari Prasad case of 1951, the landmark judgment Keshavananda Bharathi case 1973, the Minerva Mills case which said about limited amending power to the parliament, the very important landmark judgment Minerva Mills case of 1980, and you can tell about NAS Foundation case which deal about LGBTQ rights, NAS Foundation case of 2007. You can tell about Puttaswamy case, of 2017, and at last you can tell about Sabarimala judgment, Sabarimala case of 2018. So ultimately the content should be, the structure should be like this. You are going to tell what is constitutional morality. Constitutional morality is nothing but the conflict or the conflicting interest between two groups of the people in the same two groups of the people or with respect to the state and the people. So how it is going to be solved is through judicial review. And what are all the aspects of constitutional morality in our constitution? You can tell about rule of law, social justice, procedure established by law, due process of law, etc. And since the question itself asks about the judgments, you are going to tell about 2-3 judgments and you are going to complete it. And in the conclusion, you can tell about the basic structure doctrine. In the conclusion, you can tell about basic structure doctrine. So this is how you are going to proceed with this question. It's a 10 mark question. Then second question, discuss the desirability of greater representation to women in the higher judiciary to ensure diversity, equity and inclusiveness. It is about judiciary. It is about representation of women in judiciary. Okay. So this is a pure current affairs oriented question, because recently our Honorable Chief Justice of India, N.V. Ramana, discussed about this representation of women in higher judiciary. Okay. So we are going to give an introduction with some data in it. You can tell that only 11.5% of women justices are there in High Court. And you can tell that only 12% of the justices in the Supreme Court are women. That is, out of 34, only 4 women justices are there, including the Chief Justice. So 34 number of judges, in that only 4 justices are there. So representation of women is very, very poor in the higher judiciary. So that's what N.V. Ramana, the Honorable Chief Justice of India, N.V. Ramana, has recently has actually given a comment on this, and he has also given a quotation, and he quoted it that it is not the mercy, or it is not the matter of charity for giving representation to the women in the judiciary. It is about their right. You can even write this if it strikes in your mind at the time of examination. And why this lower representation is there? You can tell about collegium system. You can tell about collegium system, how it is not so like transparent. You can tell about the problems like gender diversity is not there in legal education. Gender diversity is not there in legal education. And even if you go to the high courts or the supreme courts, the clients will mostly prefer the male advocates. So again, you have gender parity in practicing law. In practicing law. So these facts are very, very important. And what is the need for actually giving more representation to the women? So there are lots and lots of cases, lots and lots of interpretations need to be made with respect to the women's in the constitution and also in the legal side. So without the proper representation of women in the judiciary, it is not going to happen. Okay. So we're talking about giving 33% reservation in legislature. We are talking about 33% reservation in jobs, etc. But one of the most important organ of this entire constitution, that is the judiciary, is not having representation of the women. It is only 11% or 12%. So it need to be addressed, otherwise justice for the women will be denied. So that is actually breaching the constitutional principles of this country. Okay. So this is the crux of the question, right? Third question. How have the recommendations of the 14th Finance Commission of India enabled the states to improve their fiscal position? Again, it's a current affairs plus a static combined question. So the question is about 14th Finance Commission. In the introduction, you are going to tell about, in the introduction, you are going to tell about the Finance Commission. Finance Commission, as per Article 280, it is a quasi judicial body. Okay. So you're going to tell about these things in the introduction. Then you're going to tell about what is the role of the Finance Commission? That is distribution of tax procedures. Distribution of tax proceeds. So this distribution is done through two ways. One is horizontal distribution and another is vertical distribution. So these are all things you can tell. Then you can go into the 14th Finance Commission. So what are all the key recommendations of the 14th Finance Commission? First is, it has ignored the distinction between plan and non-plan expenditures of the states. It's very, very important. So because of this, the states will have greater autonomy in their fiscal responsibility. They'll have greater autonomy. Greater autonomy will be there. So this is one point. And second thing is that the devolution has been increased to 42%. So 42% it has been increased from 32%. So this will give again greater autonomy to the states. Okay. And one of the most important aspects of this 14th Finance Commission is that it has given more stress on panchayats and municipalities. So regarding the funds to the panchayats and municipalities, it has again divided into basic grants and performance grants. Basic grants and performance grants. This will again give financial autonomy, great financial autonomy to the states. Great financial autonomy to the states. And another important point is that the commission has departed from the previous conventions regarding grants in aids. How this grants in aids has been given? So previously it has been like more or less, it is on the distinctions of the government. It is on the discretion and distinctions of the government. Now it has been made a statutory obligation. So because of that, the states are going to get the grants as per the Finance Commission's recommendations. So these are all some of the important Finance Commission's recommendations. But still, how the financial autonomy of the state can be increased means, again, this has to be done as per the recommendations of the Finance Commission. The government should follow the Finance Commission recommendations and give the devolution to the states. So this should be your conclusion. So you are going to tell about the Finance Commission in the introduction, and in the body you are going to tell about some important recommendations of the 14th Finance Commission. Then you are going to give the conclusion with respect to how it will increase the financial autonomy of the state. So this is what is the structure of the answer. Okay. Then fourth question, to what extent in your view the parliament is able to ensure the accountability of the executive in India? It's a very direct question. Again and again it has been asked in prelims and mains in many years in the UPSC examinations, and it has been repetitive in nature, the executive's responsibility to the legislature. So to start with this question, in the introduction you need to tell about Article 75, that is collective responsibility. Collective responsibility of the executives to the legislature, that is Lok Sabha. So you want to tell this in the introduction. Then you are going to tell lots of other aspects, how the responsibility of the executives is done. So you can tell about first the constitutional provisions like passing of the bill, that is Article 107, Article 108 and Money Bill. Article 110. This is dealing with joint sitting and this is dealing with passing of bills. And Money Bill, Article 110. Then you can tell about Consolidated Fund of India. That is financial control. Financial control of the parliament on the executive. You cannot take any money from the Consolidated Fund of India without the approval of the parliament. That is the legislature. Then you can tell about PAC, Public Accounts Committee. How this Public Accounts Committee is having a scrutiny on the executive's spending. Okay, you can tell about this point also. Then you can tell about the tools in the parliamentary proceedings like question hour, zero hour, etc. Then, now you have said about all the aspects how the executives are made accountable to the legislature. Now, there are also certain kinds of drawbacks, certain kinds of lacunes in the responsibility, right? So, what are all those lacunes? You can tell about single party dominance. So, when single party dominance is there, if the opposition is weak, then the legislative control over the executive is not so good. It is not so effective. So, you want to tell about this and you want to explain about it. Then you can tell about Ordinance Raj. How the executives are, Article 123. How the executives are bypassing the legislature through this Ordinance Raj. So, this you can explain. Then again, you can explain about delegated legislations. Delegated legislations. So, what is delegated legislation? What is the role of the parliament? The parliament need to make the law. That is, the legislature need to make the law. But in the meanwhile, the role has been delegated to the executive. And now the parliament is only discussing and passing the laws. It is not making the laws. So, this is also one of the important aspect. And you can also give some recent examples to substantiate your points. It's a very, very simple question. Okay. Next, we'll go to the 15 mark questions. So, first four questions are from polity in the 10 mark questions. We have discussed all the four. We'll go to the 15 mark questions. Question number 11. The jurisdiction of the Central Bureau of Investigation regarding lodging the FIR and conducting probe within a particular state is being questioned by various states. However, the power of the state to withhold the consent to the CBI is not absolute. Explain with special reference to the federal character of India. See here, this is actually a current affairs oriented question. So, it deals about CBI. So, recently, the states like West Bengal, Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra have withdrawn their consent given to the CBI. So, that's why this question has been asked. It's a very, very important question and it is a 15 mark question. You want to deal in detail about the CBI and the consent as per the Delhi Special Police Establishment Act. So, 11th question. In the introduction, you want to tell about CBI. It is an executive body deriving the powers from Delhi Special Police Establishment Act. Okay, so there are two types of concerned are there as per the Delhi Special Police Establishment Act. Types of concerned. One is general concern and another is specific concern. General concern, once it is given, the CBI can go into the state and probe into any cases. Specific concern with respect to each and every specific cases. So, general concerns is actually dealt in Section 6 of Delhi Special Police Establishment Act. Okay. So, if a general concern is given by a state to the CBI, So it need not want to take the permission of the state each and every time when it wants to probe into a case. Okay. So this is general concern. Okay. So now the problem is this general concern. So states like West Bengal, Andhra Pradesh, and Maharashtra have general concern to CBI. So what will be the effect of this action? So this is the question, and how it is actually against the federal character of the country. Okay. So after the withdrawal of the general concern, the CBI will lose the power of the police officers inside the state. Once they enter the state, they will become a normal people. They will not have any roles of the police officers once the general concern is withdrawn. Okay. So it will actually hamper or impact the investigation of the CBI in corruption cases or in whatever cases it might be. Okay. So what will, why this has been done? For example, the federal structure of India actually allows the state to and the center to function in an autonomous manner in normal circumstances, and in extraordinary circumstances like emergency, the thing will change into unitary. But what happens is that in the past, in the near past, the CBI has been used as a tool to actually threaten the state governments. So that's why the state governments like West Bengal, Andhra Pradesh, and Maharashtra has withdrawn the concern. Okay. So now the center cannot go and probe into the states without the consent of the state. So then what is the reply from the center? Now the states have withdrawn it. Then what is the reply from the center? It is going to affect the role of the CBI in the states or what? So what is going to be the impact on the center? The center says that, for example, if the judiciary is actually giving a judgment to involve CBI in a case, then the states cannot deny it. States have taken the general concern, but still withdrawn the general concern, but still, if the judiciary is routing the CBI to actually probe into a case, then the states cannot say no. And one more thing is that very, very important aspect here is that, for example, a probe has been happening in some other state where the general concern is still there, and the officers who are involved in that case are working in West Bengal or Andhra Pradesh or in Maharashtra, means now also the CBI can probe into that officers. Are you getting my point? So directly they will not go and probe into that state, but the case will have links to some other states like West Bengal or Andhra Pradesh and Maharashtra. Then indirectly they can probe into the officers. So what I mean to say here is that even after withdrawing the general concern, the CBI is not going to absolutely relieved from the powers what it has with respect to the states. Even after withdrawing the general concern, the CBI can still actually probe into the cases through judicial proceedings and through, like, some other states, when some other states are involved in that case, and through that process they can address the case. Are you getting my point? So the question has rightly been asked, yes, it is not going to take the absolute power of the CBI with respect to the states. Yes. So this is the structure of the answers. You want to explain in detail about the working of the CBI, what is general concern, what is specific concern, what will be the impact if it is being withdrawn, why the states have withdrawn, why the states like West Bengal, Andhra Pradesh have withdrawn the general concern, how it is affecting the federal character of the country. So this is the content. Question number 12. Though the Human Rights Commission have contributed immensely to the protection of human rights in India, yet they have failed to assert themselves against the mighty and powerful. Analyzing their structural and practical limitations suggests remedial measures. So again, this is a very repetitive question. Before 2 years also, the same question has been asked in different format in UPSC mains. You know, this, even though this Human Rights Commission is a statutory organization given a lot of powers, but still, it has certain lacunes. Even the Supreme Court of India, before 2 years, in a judgment, they have mentioned this Human Rights Commission has a toothless tiger. So this question is both a mix of current affairs and static. First, in the introduction, you want to tell about the National Human Rights Commission. It's a statutory body. It's a statutory body as per Protection of Human Rights Act. Protection of Human Rights Act 1993. So then you are going to tell about the problems. See here, in the appointment of the National Human Rights Commission itself, some problems are there. See here, the National Human Rights Commission will be appointed by a panel consisting of Prime Minister, Home Minister, Leader of Opposition in the Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, Speaker of the Lok Sabha and Deputy Chairman of the Rajya Sabha. So here itself the conflict starts. Both the ruling party and the opposition party are going to involve. There will be always tussle in actually appointing a commission, that is Human Rights Commission. And other thing is that it lacks autonomy. The very important point is lack of autonomy. Lack of autonomy. Okay. It doesn't have sufficient officers, no sufficient officers to probe. No sufficient officers to probe. Okay. Then it is not having punitive power. It is only recommendatory in nature. It is not having punitive power. It is only recommendatory in nature. Okay. Its verdicts are not binding. Its verdicts are not binding. Okay. So these are all the problems with the Human Rights Commission. So how it can be like solved? Simple. Again, you want going to solve all the problems, right? You want to give punitive power. You can give separate cadre officers for the National Human Rights Commission. And you can make the decisions or the verdicts binding on the people concerned or the organs concerned. And one of the very big lacunae of this Human Rights Commission is that one of the most important thing is that armed forces, the atrocities or the violations of human rights done by armed forces are not covered. You can tell about the example of AFSPA. It is not covered. Are getting me point? So these are all the things. And an independent investigative organ has to be created to help this National Human Rights Commission, because every time they will be relying on the police department or the state government to actually investigate the cases. That is not going to help in getting the human rights back. And one more important thing is that here, when a human rights violation has been happened, within 1 year, the commission need to start its investigation. So after 1 year, the commission don't have any power to start its investigation. This is also one of the very big loophole in the functioning of the National Human Rights Commission. Okay. So the question is a 15 mark question. So you need to tell something about what are all the achievements of the Human Rights Commission also. Okay. It has reformed the prisons. It has addressed many atrocities happened against downtrodden and vulnerable people like SCs, STs, etc. You can tell about the handcuffing, the problem of handcuffing. The criminals, handcuffing the criminals has been like removed from the practice because of the National Human Rights Commission only. Many things. It has done many things to actually abolish the bonded labor in the country. Okay. Child labor in the country has been reduced because of the actions of Human Rights Commission. So many achievements it has done, but still, it has some lacunes like these points, and you are going to suggest some recommendations to get rid of these points. And in the conclusion, you can tell about the Supreme Court observing that this Human Rights Commission is a toothless tiger. But if we rectify the problems through the recommendations given, then this toothless tiger can be turning into a tiger with more number of tooth to address the problems of human rights. So this is what the question should be addressed in the same way, through the proper introduction, points for like how the Human Rights Commission has done a good job and what are all the lacunes, then the remedies, then the conclusion. Okay. Question number 13. Analyze the distinguishing features of the notion of right to equality in the Constitution of US and India. This question seems to be somewhat difficult, but it is a very simple question. So right to equality has two things: procedure established by law, or equality before law, and equal protection of law. Equality before law is UK concept, and equal protection of law is US concept. And again, we follow two other principles to actually like deal with the cases. One is procedure established by law, and another is due process of law. Okay, but our constitution started with procedure established by law, whereas due process of law is actually followed in US, and later on we adapted this due process of law. So we are going to deal in detail about the rule of law. Rule of law, that is equality before law and equal protection of law. Then you are going to deal about procedure established by law and due process of law. So there is a difference between Indian convention and the US convention. So first you are going to tell about equality before law. So equality before law, it's a UK concept. It's a UK concept. It is followed in India. It's a negative concept. This equality before law is usually followed in political aspects. Political rights. Tell about the examples of right to vote. Then you can tell about equal protection of law. It's a US concept, and actually this is both is actually followed in India. Both is followed in India. It's an US concept. It is a positive concept. It deals mostly with socio-economic rights. Example, you can tell about reservation or affirmative action. So going to tell about this in detail. Okay. Then you can also explain about, you can also explain about procedure established by law and due process of law. Procedure established by law, again, it is a UK concept. It's followed in India. And this law, procedure established by law, deals with, it will check only whether the law made is correct or not. It is not going to check whether the law is itself correct or not. Are you getting my point? So this procedure established by law was the backbone of the Indian constitution. Okay. So it was reaffirmed in Gopalan case. Gopalan case of 1950. Then coming back to due process of law, it's a US concept again, but it was not the backdrop of the Indian constitution. Later on, it was adapted. Okay. So it checks whether the law is itself correct or not. Okay. So due process of law, then it was actually reaffirmed in Menaka case of 1978. Okay, so you are going to explain all these concepts with respect to India and US, and you are going to give some examples like affirmative action, reservation, political rights. You're going to tell about these two judgments like Gopalan case and Menaka case, etc., in order to justify this question. Okay, it's a pure factual question. You are going to explain about the constitutional provisions of right to equality through the mirrors of US Constitution and also the Indian Constitution. And you can also tell about how this process of judicial review comes from due process of law. Actually, the concept of judicial review is itself a US concept only, because they follow judicial supremacy. So even though the Indian Constitution has adapted the judicial review in Article 13, It was widened because of the concepts like judicial activism. Okay. So you can tell about these things also in this question. Because it is a 15 mark question, you can explain in detail about each and every thing. Okay. Then, question number 14. Explain the constitutional provisions under which the legislative councils are established. Review the working and current status of legislative council with suitable illustrations. It is a non-conventional question. Usually this legislative councils were not asked in the UPSC mains examinations. It was the first time I think it has been asked in the near future. Possibly before that, before like 4-5 years, it might be asked. But in the recent times, it is asked. Yeah, the recent times it is asked for the first time in 2022 mains. Okay, we'll see. Question number 14 about legislative council. So they have asked us to tell about the constitutional provisions of legislative council, then to tell about its effectiveness. First, you need to tell about the constitutional provisions. In the introduction, you can tell about Article 169, which deals with the procedure and abolition of legislative council. You should tell this in introduction. Then, what is the procedure for the creation and abolition of the legislative council? First thing is that the parliament can create it by an act. So, for this to be done, a specific resolution to be passed in the legislative assembly of the particular state with special majority. Then it will be created by a simple majority in parliament. So this amendment to the constitution will not be under Article 368 of the constitution. So it can be created by an act of the parliament. This act can be made by a specific resolution passed in the legislative assembly of the particular state. Then by simple majority, it can be created in the parliament. And this amendment to the constitution is not going to be under Article 368, that is amendment to the constitution. Okay. Then the maximum strength of the legislative council should be one third of the legislative assembly, and the minimum, and this can be changed as per the parliament. This can be changed as per the parliament. So the maximum will be one third of the legislative assembly and minimum will be 40. So what the constitution has laid, the procedure, what kind of procedure it has laid, means it is a very, because it is a very unconventional question. So we'll deal in detail about this question. So manner of election of legislative councils. The entire seats will be divided into one third plus one third plus one third. This one third will be elected by the MLAs of the state, and this one third by the district boards and local bodies. By the local bodies. This one third will in turn be divided into 1/6 and 1/6. And this 1/6 will be nominated by the governor. And this 1/6 is in turn divided into 1/12 and 1/12. This 1/12 are elected by the graduates of the state. And this 1/12 are elected by the teachers, not lower than secondary grade. Not lower than secondary grade. So this is the system of election that is followed for legislative council. So if you take this entire election process, it is one of the tedious process. So 5/6 will be indirectly elected and 1/6 will be nominated. And the strength of the legislative council is actually maintained very less as that of the legislative assembly, because to give more importance to legislative assembly, it is only a nominated body and indirectly elected body. It is not going to have any powers with the passing of legislations in the state. Are you getting my point? So you should not compare this Rajya Sabha with Legislative Council. Rajya Sabha has more powers when comparing to Legislative Council in the state respectively. Okay, so you're going to tell what is Legislative Council, how many states, 6 states are having Legislative Council, what is the procedure, what is the constitutional aspect that is dealing with the Legislative Council. Now you are going to tell what are all the problems with the Legislative Council. This Legislative Council is mostly actually seen as a political body. So in order to satisfy the needs of the politicians, that's it. It is not going to do anything because its powers are very, very, very limited. Are you getting my point? So recently also you can tell about the Maharashtra Chief Minister's nomination to the Legislative Council was actually denied by or delayed by the governor. These are all actually politically motivated actions. So that is why the function of this Legislative Council is again and again criticized. Why this body is there? Why should we have a Legislative Council? So many states like Tamil Nadu previously had Legislative Council, but it was abolished before 30-40 years itself. Okay, so this is the content of the question. It is not required that you all of you should draw this chart to explain the Legislative Council. If you remember it, you can write it. Otherwise, you can tell about the process of election, because the question is asked about the constitutional provisions of Legislative Council. Okay, then you want to tell about the problems in the Legislative Council. Okay, the last question of polity in this paper, question number 15. Do the department related standing committees keep the administration on its toes and inspire reverence for parliamentary control? Evaluate the working of such committees with suitable example. So the question is about parliamentary committees. Before 2 years, again, there was a question asked from estimates committee in the UPSC mains. Now again, a question has been asked from departmental standing committees. Okay. You want to explain what is the role of this departmental standing committee? So 15th question. So to make the executives accountable to the legislature. Okay. So if you take the departmental standing committees, 24 departmental standing committees are there, in which 8 are from Rajya Sabha and 16 are from Lok Sabha. So 24 numbers of departmental standing committees are there, 8 are from Rajya Sabha and 16 are from Lok Sabha. Okay, if you take the members of the departmental standing committee, it will have 31 members, 21 are from Lok Sabha and 10 are from Rajya Sabha. And how the members are being elected means they are nominated by the speaker and chairman. They're nominated by the speaker and the chairman. Okay. They're nominated by the speaker and the chairman. And ministers are not eligible to be the members. Ministers are not eligible to be the members. The term of the committee is 1 year. The term of the committee is 1 year. So what is the main role of this departmental standing committee is that to make the executives accountable. To make the executive accountable. This is the main role. So again, this might be a static question, but still, It was there in current affairs. Why? Because recently the Rajya Sabha Secretariat has given a guidelines, with respect to this departmental standing committees. They say that the nomination of the members should be based on qualifications. And interest of the members. And at least there should be 50% attendance to conduct a standing committee meeting, departmental standing committee meeting. So what is the major function of this departmental standing committee means? It should actually check the working of the executive then and there and make the parliamentary proceedings more healthy. But the problem here is that because of single party dominance in the legislature, the number of members in this departmental standing committee are more or less from the ruling party, just actually reducing the role or reducing the effectiveness of the standing committees and making the executive accountable to the parliament. So that is the problem here. That is why this question is again asked. Nowadays the standing committee's role has been slowly getting reduced and standing committee is not working in a proper way. Whether this election process is sufficient or whether it need to be given more independence to the standing committees, it need to be discussed in your answer. So we have discussed all the questions with respect to polity. Okay, we have discussed all the questions with respect to polity in mains 2022. So other questions will be discussed by the faculties concerned. So thank you.
So in paper 2 governance, UPSC mains question, we'll discuss the answers for this question. So question number 5, I'll read the question. Pressure groups play a vital role in influencing public policy making in India. Explain how the business associations contribute to public policies. So in this question, as an introduction, you can say what is pressure groups means. That's nothing but an institutions trying to influence the public policy or people opinion. That is called pressure groups. So you can also list out the methods on which pressure groups are able to influence public policies. So there are multiple methods on which they are able to influence them, by means of policy research, by means of media briefing, or they also go for extreme like demonstrations, strikes, hartals. These are another mechanisms. So this is not done by formal institutions, what given in the question, just to give the exposure to the examiner that these are the methods on which they try to influence the public policies. This can be the two paragraphs, or you can combine all this in one paragraph. But the major focus of the question is, okay, you are addressing the first part of the question. Explain the pressure groups play a vital role in influencing public policies, public policy making in India. For that only, just first paragraph, you can write all those things. What I said, what is pressure group and what are the methods used by pressure groups. Second is, explain how the business association contribute to public policies. Here you need to understand this business association means we need to list out which are the business associations right now in India have a huge influence on public policies. So what are the biggest business associations? One is FICCI, Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industries, ASSOCHAM, the Associated Chamber of Commerce and Industry of India, CII. All these are industrial bodies and associations. And for software industries, we have NASSCOM. And for manufacturing industries, especially for automobiles, we have SIAM, S-I-A-M. And apart from this, we also have US-India Business Council, which is also an association in business world. So you can list out all these associations are there in India. And when you take public policy, they have given a general term, public policy. Especially where these associations have a huge influence is starting with trade policy, tax policies, FDI policies, and manufacturing policies. Even in nuclear policy, we have an impact. We'll see all these areas, how they have an impact is. Especially if we take this tax policies, where we can see that FICCI and CII, every year before budget, they try to meet the finance minister or possible prime minister and trying to say their side of budget, what need to be done, what type of tax structures they are visualizing. So all this are the influence on policy, public policy of India. So one is regarding tax policies. They try to influence the government on this. This is one area you can explain it, how FICCI and CAA are trying to do this. The next thing is regarding export, import and FDI policy, where you can say about ASSOCHAM, where they try to influence the government on determining the export import policies, especially like custom duties and all those things, and what are products need to be there. All this will be influencing, not determining, influencing the government on these factors. That you can explain. And similarly, FDI policies, foreign direct investment policies, where they try to play a huge role in it. And similarly, regarding manufacturing policy, we can say about SIAM, which is a Association for Automobile Industries. They try to influence the government on this manufacturing policies. Even we can say about this vehicle scrappage policy, which is recently announced by the government, where this SIAM has a huge influence on the government, saying that what should be the number of years the commercial vehicles need to be there in public, and which after certain years, how this need to be removed. And they are saying the possibility, what other things can be done. So all this we can relate here, how they try to influence the government on these areas. And similarly, when you go for this manufacturing policy, what I said is SIAM. So even if you take this nuclear policy, where we can see this nuclear liability issue, which was happening in India, when foreigners coming to India to establish a nuclear reactors, where this association has influence on the government based on the previous industrial accident of Bhopal Gas Tragedy. They try to influence the government on determining this nuclear liability, what should be the financial cost, all those things. So if you take all these different areas and try to associate with one of the associations, what I just listed out, and trying to influence them, and write as a point, that's enough. So public policy is a general term, which you want to split into trade policies, tax policies, FDA policies, nuclear policies, manufacturing policies. In manufacturing policy, you can also relate with vehicle scrappage policy and all. So all this you write as a point. And finally, in last paragraph, it's an explained question, which is not required, but you can also put in last paragraph, what are challenges these associations are facing? One of the biggest challenges what they are facing is, first one is leadership crisis. Next one is regarding rivalry among these associations. To give a good example, FICCI is called a Birla block because it was started by Birla, whereas ASSOCHAM is considered to be Bombay block. There is always a rivalry between these associations, that can be said. The next thing is, in current situation, these associations depend too much on government for money, because all these associations have some land parcels where they have some real estates infrastructures, which is taken by the government for conducting events and all. Right now, this becomes the biggest influencing factor on decisions of these associations. And apart from this, the most important thing is, these associations doesn't have a huge influence on state governments. So these are some of the challenges. Last paragraph, you can write it. So that is question number 5. And question number 6, besides being a moral imperative of a welfare state, primary health structure is a necessary precondition for sustainable development analysis. Here, what you need to focus is, first you need to address, besides being moral imperative of a welfare state. So you can say, what is welfare state means? Okay. So welfare state is nothing but taking care of the needs of the people from birth to death. That is called welfare state. And primary health is a moral imperative. If you are running a country on a welfare state objective, primary health structure or primary health in structure is the most important requirement. It's a moral dimension. It's not only in the aspect of practical aspects. It's more about moral, to keep the well-being of the people. So health well-being is the most important thing. That you can write as a first paragraph. The next thing is, primary health structure, how that results in sustainable development. When you say primary health structure, you should not think only from structure. Is not only based on infrastructures. So you can say both hospitals is one. Apart from hospitals, you can also relate policy dimensions. Policies also play a major role in this. So primary health structure, which includes policies and hospitals, all play a major role in sustainable development. Here, to understand this term sustainable development, you can relate with sustainable development goals. There are 17 goals in sustainable development. So in this, we just split into 3 major areas how this primary health structure is important. I'll just list out some of the important 17 goals. In that, For example, gender equality, quality education, hunger and poverty, reduction of hunger, reduction of poverty, and responsible consumption and production, decent work and economic growth, life on land and life below water. These are some of the important 17 goals, among the 17 goals of the sustainable development. And we are trying to link this to this particular answer. So the question is regarding primary health structure, how that results in sustainable development. So when you're having this primary health structure, that's nothing but starting with hospitals and policies, how they are going to address all these problems. We can split into three major areas. One is social sustainability, economic sustainability, and ecological sustainability. So what is social sustainability means? If you have a very good primary health structure, so that's the demand of the question, primary health structure, what that results in social sustainability. That's nothing but gender equality and reduction in hunger and poverty. When you are able to provide the primary health services to the people, especially regarding disadvantaged sections like women and children, ultimately that results in greater gender equality and reduction in hunger and poverty in the society. So that results in sustainable development. So that you can say as the first paragraph, social sustainability. That is second and third paragraph. Next thing is, you can relate with economic sustainability. When you say economic sustainability, when we have a proper primary health structure, that makes sure that people are eligible for work, and ultimately that results in better pay, and ultimately that results what we call it as in sustainable development goals, decent work and economic growth. So that gives a sustainable lifestyle for the people. That is called economic sustainability. You can explain that with this sustainable development goals, how primary health structure is important here. And finally, ecological sustainability. When you say ecological sustainability, how this primary health is important is life on land and life below water. Sorry, if this health is not taken into consideration, when this primary health structure is not in proper in a society, ultimately you can see that has a huge impact on land and water. How we can relate this is, right now we can see that government is giving greater focus on LPG cylinders and all. It's also a policy to promote health in our rural areas. And if there is no such thing, you can see that people are depending too much on wood as a natural resource for heating and cooking purpose. And that has a huge impact on land and water. So you're just trying to relate all these things. So for the sixth question, you need to say about what is social sustainability, economic sustainability, and ecological sustainability. So for this, that's question number six. Next thing is question number seven. Earn while you learn scheme needs to be strengthened to make vocational education and skill training meaningful government. So recently this was a scheme announced by the government, Earn While You Learn. From the name itself, we can understand. And what the recent news article says is that is being promoted by Ministry of Tourism. We'll just write some of the factual information regarding this scheme, Earn While You Learn. So Ministry of Tourism focusing on students and student volunteers, primarily focusing on them. And eligibility condition, you just write all this in paragraphs. 18 to 25 years and 21-day training program is given so that they can be employed in tourism sector. And another most important thing is there are some other guidelines is also given for this Earn While You Learn. First and foremost thing is it's a part-time employment which can be created in public sector, public sector, private sector, other organizations, and especially local governments, it can be created. And what the law says is 90 days per year will be given as a job opportunity. And it is also given instruction to government departments to earmark around 15% of the fund for this particular type of activity. So these are the factual statements regarding Earn While You Learn. And all you write it in two paragraphs. And Earn While You Learn scheme need to be strengthened to make vocational educational skill training meaningful common. So how it can be strengthened is, first and foremost thing is, this has a greatest benefit for all the stakeholders. All the stakeholders, right from students, because students, what are the greatest benefit is they are able to have financial independence, especially during their graduation days. And that you need to relate mostly with weaker sections, especially SC, ST and women. they got a greater opportunity. So ultimately, that has a huge impact on the system. So this will promote this vocational education and skill training for disadvantaged people because they are not financially dependent upon any other during their graduation times. And another most important thing to strengthen this, what are things need to be focused? This first and foremost thing is the training module should be more career based along with their graduation so that the students will be more interested to go for this particular scheme because they have a greatest impact on their career based on the graduation. So you need to link all these things, their graduation and career based training for earn while you learn. So that need to be done. Apart from this, there should be a greater industry industry and university linkage should be established so that most of the training is more relevant for the industry requirement. That need to be done. Second one. Third one is, it is suggested that especially for the students, this should be part of their records, assessment record for their graduation, which gives a greater incentive for the students to focus on it. So ultimately, if you do all these things, that will strengthen this vocational training and skill training for a Skill India program. So that's regarding question number 7. And question number 8, can the vicious cycle of gender inequality, poverty and malnutrition be broken through microfinancing of women's self-help group? Explain with examples. First paragraph, you can say what is self-help group and importance of self-help group in the structure. So self-help group is a group of 10 to 12, 15 women joining together, creating a collective identity for financial inclusion. They are linked with the banking system so that they'll enjoy the financial services. This role you can write it in first paragraph. And they have given 3 separate dimensions. One is gender inequality, poverty and malnourishment. How this is all being addressed through self-help group? You want to give it examples. So whenever we say this examples, self-help group, we know that in India, it all comes under one major umbrella scheme, National Rural Livelihood Missions, based on which, wherein especially in rural areas, the self-help groups are formed to transform the women's life. So in this, we take few examples and try to explain with this question. One, we can say that the first self-help group model was started in 1972. It's a self-initiative, that is Self-Employed Women's Association, popularly called the SEWA. Self-Employed Women's Association, popularly called as SEWA. Thus, you can relate with gender inequality. How this particular association able to address the problem of gender inequality? When you say gender inequality is a common term, you can say about financial inequality. So it created an opportunity for women. And this particular SEWA is focused more on poor women and especially working in informal sectors. So they want to make sure that they have a reliable work opportunity for them. So ultimately, they can transform their life and they want to be financially independent. They want to create financial equality in the family. So SEWA can be related with this concept of gender inequality. You can write it and you can mix up the examples. I'm just giving some examples to relate with this particular 3 major areas. You can mix up also. The next thing is the most popular self-help group in India is Kudumbashree, which is a most successful model in Kerala. And they are doing multiple activities. One, you can relate with the concept of malnourishment. Right now, this Kudumbashree is running this community kitchens and especially focusing on addressing the problem of malnourishment among children and also among teenage women and pregnant women. They're trying to focus these areas, especially in the state of Kerala, which you can use as an example to explain that how self-help groups able to address the problem of malnourishment. This is the second thing. Third one is regarding poverty. So right now, regarding poverty, there are initiatives in Odisha like Ma Santoshi Self-Help Group. Ma Santoshi Self-Help Group. This is an example which I took it from news articles saying about World Bank reports and awards given by Union Government for Self-Help Group. So what's the point I'm trying to say here is it's all known examples which we didn't read properly. But this you can write as an answer. Ma Santoshi in Odisha, which is primarily focusing on eradicating poverty among women in Odisha society, especially poor women. So similarly, there are NGOs self-help groups in Jharkhand working with district administration to alleviate poverty in Jharkhand society. So all this can be an example. You can write it and say that how self-help is transforming the malnourishment or poverty or inequality issues in our society. And finally, last one paragraph. If you want, you can write it or you can leave it. You can say that what are the challenges they are facing. And it's an explained question which is not required. So all this, you write it for four or five paragraphs. What is self-help group? And right now in India, how self-help group is established through national rural livelihood missions. And take these three examples and explain how they are able to transform the lives of the society, especially in three major areas. This is question number 8. So next we go for question number 16. Has digital literacy, particularly in rural areas, coupled with lack of information and communication technology, accessibility, hindered socioeconomic development, examined with justification? So what the question is, a 15 mark question. What the question tried to address here is, right now socioeconomic development is hindered by two major aspects. One is lack of digital literacy and lack of information and communication technology accessibility. So examine with justifications. So first we need to say that what is the importance of ICT, or what is ICT means? What is information and communication technology? That you can say as an introduction, very basic introduction. So use of modern technologies for communication and sharing of information, which comes under ICT platform. Popularly, we call that as mobile apps or e-governance initiatives, all is part of it. Or you can also say as introduction, what are the socioeconomic development means? So just write this as an introduction, and it's a 250 words. And we need to examine why this happens. So why there is always digital illiteracy? So digital illiteracy, starting basic with this, you can start with general illiteracy in a society. So especially in rural areas, that's the biggest problem. When you say this general illiteracy is, you can give some factual informations, especially literacy rate among women, literacy rate among SC and STs. So what are the present status of India? So once they are illiterate, ultimately that has an impact on various aspects of the life. You can say about how that impacts the digital illiteracy, because they are not aware to read basic things in their life. So ultimately, they are not able to use their technology properly. That's a justification. So why this is happening? So digital literacy is happening because the starting is always starts with this lack of literacy. So that transforms into digital literacy. This can also be related to financial literacy. Why they are financially not well off? Again, lack of financial literacy resulting with lack of literacy. Here, what you want to do is you speak about how the literacy rates are very low in rural areas. For this, you need to give some factual statements regarding SC, STs, regarding women in rural areas, and even state-specific information you can also say. For example, if you take Bihar or UP, you compare and say that how the socioeconomic development or HTA index is very low there. And in this, you can also give the comparative scales of Kerala, where the literacy rates are very high, and what is the HTA index, what they are standing. So all this should be the answers for two or three paragraphs saying that why digital literacy is biggest hindrance there. So that is one. So first you need to say what are this ICT platform is. And next thing is, you can say digital literacy, you relate with literacy problem in the rural areas. General literacy problems is a major cause. In that, you split into literacy among women, literacy among SC and ST. Here you can do a comparative study between UP, Bihar, or UP, Bihar as one side and Kerala another side. Just in tabular column, you relate all these things and say that how digital literacy is the biggest hindrance for socioeconomic development. This is one part of the answer. Next part of the answer is, if they are coupled with information and communication technology accessibility. So right now we can see that ICT accessibility is another problem in rural areas. Why they are not able to access? Here comes a lot of issues. One, starting with infrastructural issues. So when you say infrastructural issues, you can say that very basic infrastructures are not established in India, starting with power connections, telecom connections, and internet penetration. You can say that here you can give the recent example as a case study, which came in newspaper, especially in Odisha. People are waiting for 2 days to get their MG Narega money from bank. The major reason for this, power cut. This example came in newspaper, Hindu newspaper, which you can quote it and say that how very basic infrastructure we are lacking in India. So that is a problem for socio-economic development. One, you can start with this infrastructural issues. You can say about what is the power penetration in India, what telecom penetration in India, and apart from this mobile phone penetration in India, all this is related. So there's nothing but information and communication technology accessibility. So and apart from this, you can also say that training is another pro issue in this aspect, even if people are digitally literate. And training need to be given, especially using this technological platforms, which is not there. That is also another problem. So ultimately, if we combine all these things, that results in socioeconomic or hindering socioeconomic development. And finally, in conclusion, what are the remedial measures taken by the government? Here you can relate with the government schemes of promoting digital literacy and also infrastructure schemes like national optic fiber network or all this you can relate as a conclusion part and say that government is moving in the right direction to address these problems, and you can finish off in a positive note. Okay, so that is 16, question number 16, 15 marks. And question number 17, though women in post-independent India have excelled in various fields, the social attitude towards women and feminist movement has been patriarchal. Apart from women education and women empowerment schemes, what are interventions can help change this milieu? So here, first you need to address the first two statements. Though women in post-independence have excelled in various fields, you need to list out few examples where women excelled in various fields, starting with sports, starting with politics, starting in scientific arena. You need to list out some of the personality names, how they contributed to our India's development. That you can say it as a one or two paragraphs. I'm saying paragraphs means 30 words each. Okay, just try to explain all these things. And social attitude towards women and feminist movement has been patriarchal. So when you take the social attitude, still all this being achieved, we can see that women is not being treated equal because social attitude is similar to it. So we can see that how still Indian society is male dominated one. So you can give some factual statements for this, starting with sex ratio, or we can relate literacy rates. So all this you can say and say as list it out and say that how still India is more male dominated system, correct? So this is the one or two paragraphs at the maximum finish of all these things. Apart from women education and women empowerment schemes, you need to say that regarding women education, what are the things done in India, and regarding women empowerment scheme, you just need to list it out. You just need to explain. So all this should be for three paragraphs, all these three, starting with first point is women excelled in various fields and social attitude and women education and women empowerment scheme. You just need to list out all this in three paragraphs. Like women empowerment scheme means when you say women, you can split it into various dimensions, rural women, working women, and adolescent girls or pregnant women. A lot of schemes are created in India. List out all the schemes and say that how Indian government is promoting empowerment among women. But the question is, what interventions can help the change this milieu? Apart from this, what are other things need to be done? Which we can split into major areas. There are four major areas, starting with reservation. So when you say reservation, it's already done in the Indian system. And mostly when you say reservation, we always relate with political system. So right now, this is the right time. We need to focus on reservation at the top level, MP and MLA level. That need to be done. So right now, we have reservation for local government. That need to be done. So that should be done because women need to be in decision-making domain. So political reservation need to be there. Apart from this, regarding job, recently we can see that the Supreme Court giving an order, permanent commission for women in armed forces, that need to be promoted a lot. So that when you say reservation, it's not only political level, you need to relate with job level also. And also we can see that in corporate world, right now laws are being changed in such a way that there should be a women director in companies, especially board of directors. This all should be properly implemented to give a good impression in the society that women is also a important role, player in our Indian system. So that is one. One, you can start with reservation dimensions. How would it need to be strengthened? So that's the question is, what interventions can help change this milieu? So there's already laws are there that need to be strengthened in effective implementation. That is one. The next thing is institutional mechanism. So right now in India, we have created an institution focusing on women-centric dimensions, starting with Ministry of Women and Child Development, and we have National Commission for Women. And apart from this, we have this gender budgeting concept and all. So all this need to be effectively strengthened, proper visibility should be given for all this institutional mechanism which makes women to be the center part of a society. That should be the next set of points you want to write. So in reservation, you can split into three levels. One is political, job nature, and also corporate. And when you go for institutional mechanism, you can say ministry level, commission level, and also you can say that regarding institution, gender budgeting also. You can relate all these things. And next thing is regarding awareness and social attitude. That need to be changed a lot. When you say awareness and social attitude, so women should be given greater importance in the society. And even in social media platforms and all, how women need to be respected, all this you need to say that. So that regarding awareness and social attitude dimensions. And finally, legislative dimensions. When you say legislation, where we need to focus on recently, we can see that government focusing on marriageable age. So that can be one point which we need to be strengthened a lot. And apart from this, equal pay for equal work. Right now, we have an act that is not being properly implemented. So that need to be done. Equal pay for equal work, that need to be done. So all this can be added in your answers. There are four major categories. One is reservation, institution, awareness and social attitude towards women need to be changed. Especially here comes the role of media and also what need to be done among the society dimensions. And finally, legislative measures. So when you are able to address all these things and you are able to complete the answer for 250 words. Okay. Finally, last question, question number 18. Can civil society and non-governmental organization present an alternative model of public service delivery to benefit the common citizen? Discuss the challenges of this alternative model. As first paragraph, you can say what is civil society and NGOs means. And finally, second paragraph, you say what are the merits of them. So what is civil society and NGOs? Civil society means a group of institutions representing people's will. That is called civil society, which includes NGOs, non-governmental organizations. Next, what are unique characters of them? First is started by people themselves, have a greater people trust, last mile connectivity, all this acting as a link between people and government. All these are some of the benefits of civil society organization. These are two paragraphs. But the major focus is discuss the challenges of this alternative model. So there are a lot of challenges in this model, which can't be assumed as the best model to address the people. So what are the challenges? First and foremost thing when you take this civil society challenges is they always work for a specific interest, especially if you take NGOs. NGOs always work for a specific interest, which will not represent the entire society. If you take Greenpeace, they always work for environmental interest. They never work for the entire collective interest of society, which they will not do. So ultimately, you can see all different NGOs working on specific interest. So finding a common objective for them is always difficult. So that is the biggest challenge. That is one you can say. Next thing is, if you take the civil society and NGOs, and the next biggest problem is lack of transparency. Right now we have this FCRA Act, and especially they are not very transparent in what they are doing. That is the second one. Third one, you can say that lack of transparency in financial resources. So especially foreign funding they are receiving, and they are not very focused on where they get the money. Right now, government is addressing this problem through FCRA. That's a challenge for the system. We can't rely on them. Then apart from this, NGOs representing or civil society representing foreign interest. So that is also another biggest problem in our system. So foreign interest domination will be there. And also we can say about NGOs and business nexus, where there's an example of PATH, an international NGO, which conducted a clinical trial in the name of free medicines. So, and political NGOs. Political NGOs means NGOs started by family members and a lot of corruption was involved while implementing the government schemes. And regarding civil society, another problem is it can be hijacked by vested interest, especially pressure groups and all, which can be hijacked by vested interest. You are able to explain all the 6 points and you are able to address 250 marks. So, these are the answers for governance question. Okay, thank you.